Instead of going out to the bars, you played softball on the top of a 3,700 foot mountain, the Catskills.
Yeah.
That's pretty sweet. Anything else?
I do have one crazy story, but I'm really hoping that your listeners don't recognize themselves. Tom and I were leading a 3,500 club hike to Hunter Mountain. And on the summit of the mountain, one of the hike participants asked me a question, which really made me step back a moment. It seems that he had lost his pet goldfish very recently. And he thought his final resting place should be the summit of Hunter Mountain. And so he asked me if it would be okay if he buried his goldfish up there. And I didn't really know how to answer that. I mean, I don't know how many times the goldfish had come to the summit of Hunter with him.
Yeah.
Why he wanted it there, I don't know. But that was kind of a bizarre question.
This was an adult?
It was an adult.
Okay. I think I could see a 9-year-old kid doing that, but not an adult. Oh, man. Interesting. Did you just be like leave no trace, but, RIP.
Wherever you go in the Catskills, you could look down and imagine glaciers below you.
I think the weather challenges on this incident were particularly difficult.
Whereas Panson Mountain is totally opposite. It's a mountain on top of a crater.
It is really the development of New York State. Catskills were responsible.
Yeah!
Welcome to Inside the Line, the Catskills. So, how's it going, guys? Good?
It's going good.
Yeah, well. Good.
So, did you guys hear about the right rescue up in the Adirondacks, the Singapore man?
I did.
Isn't that crazy?
It was crazy. I am very glad that he did one thing well, and that was leaving his itinerary with someone at home.
Yeah, so exactly.
They knew he was in trouble.
So, yeah, for those who didn't know, a forest ranger rescued a man in from Singapore last week who had been missing from the Adirondack for days. I think they calculated 3 days. The 58-year-old man had last been in contact with his wife back in Singapore on the evening of Sunday, June 19th. On Wednesday morning, rangers found the man's rental car in the Elk Lake parking area, and he had signed in the trailhead register, which is like what Laurie said, you sign in, this will help you a lot. Yeah. But he didn't sign out. So 11 forest rangers searched throughout the Dix Range, which is a pretty crappy range. It's beautiful, but crappy. Assuming that the man was off trail. At 2:50 on Wednesday, a ranger found the missing hiker in a swamping area. This gets interesting. According to state officials, the man's face was covered in bug bites, his pants were tattered, and his boots were falling apart. And the man was finally helped out of the swamp and evaluated by Schroon Lake EMS. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I heard that, and I was just like, oh, wow, that's pretty interesting stuff.
Yeah, like I said, I really felt in a way that he was lucky. I mean, he must have told someone back home about renting the car and at least a bit about his destination and expectations of return. There was certainly a long period of time before they started looking, but at least it was a start. And again, that signing in at the register. All those things sure helped the rangers because I think he was lucky.
Yeah. Especially in the Adirondacks. How far is, if he's in the Dix Range, how far is he away from any source of civilization?
Oh, my goodness. I mean, it depends on where he was. He could have gone a long ways, east or west, and not seen a soul.
Yeah. It's crazy. There was also something in the Catskills. A man, 61-year-old man from Long Island, fell down the embankment of the Catterskill Rail Trail. I didn't know about this. Fell 30 feet, and he had no memory of the fall, which is pretty crazy. Severe rib pain and broken wrist. And Ranger Gilliam was joined by Rangers Alwyn, Dawson, and Martin to set up a steep angle raise using a sked and vacuum mattresses, which is pretty wicked. I can't believe that. That's way crazy. And he was raised back to the trail. So that was, I didn't hear about that until like last night, actually.
No, I hadn't heard about it either.
Yeah. I didn't know. I'm going to have to look into that vacuum master. It's for the SAR team. That's pretty fun.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. So, excellent. Well, going over a little rescue stuff. So, welcome, Laurie and Tom. How are you tonight? Welcome to the episode, I think it's 39 of Inside awesome. The Line. So, thank you for joining me. My friends, Laurie and Tom, are here. Big time hikers in the Catskills, the Adirondacks, the Whites, correct, too?
Yeah, you name it.
Yeah, we've done the Northeast 115.
Oh, yeah. Yana said you're a winter 115er, right?
We are.
Yes, we are.
One in the like 98, correct?
Something like that.
Yeah, pretty small numbers. It
creeps up a little every year.
Crazy. Yeah, just a little bit, though. That is crazy. So thank you for joining me. I'd like to thank the monthly subscribers, Darren White and John Comiskey, Vicky Ferreira, Jim C., Michael Bogner, Alec Betancourt, and Sarah Bacon. Thank you guys very much for contributing to the show. I am having tonight a Coke and Rev Spirits from Stanford. Very good stuff.
Oh, I haven't had that.
Yeah. You get it at that 5 o'clock somewhere liquor store in Stanford. It's very good.
Have to check it out.
Yeah. You guys having anything or suggest anything?
Well, I've got a keg of Avenue of the Pines IPA from Northway Brewing. I'm not drinking it right now, but I had it with dinner.
Excellent. Avenue of the Pines, correct?
Yes. They also make a session IPA, Sunrise Session,
which excellent. We have as well. I'll put that in the show notes. Excellent. And Laurie, you're having you showed me before a good old cup of water.
I'm just having a glass of water this evening, but if it was just a little bit warmer, my drink of choice this evening would have been cucumber vodka.
Ooh.
With some cranberry lime seltzer and a little cranberry juice. Very refreshing.
Especially on the hot days. It was just a muggy day today.
Yeah.
It was very, very odd. But it's been like that the past couple of days, and it died down tonight. It feels really good out there.
Yeah.
Especially with you guys. You guys got the mountains around you, so you probably got a little cooler temperature.
Yes, and we always have a nice breeze, too.
Yeah, we usually subtract 5 degrees from whatever it says in Binghamton.
Oh, wow, yeah. That's a hell of a difference.
Yeah.
Excellent. So I want to promote, once again, the 3500 Trailhead Stewards. If you guys want to be a Trailhead Steward, check it out. I have the links in every one of my podcasts ever since it started. Very fun, very cool. We're going to talk about being stewards tonight with Laurie and Tom, because they're very big stewards of the Catskills and of the Adirondacks and of New York State, actually, in several different ways. So it'll be great to talk about that. Also, check out the Catskills Trail Crew. Does trail maintenance all around the Catskills. Very awesome trail maintenance, cleaning out water bars, making new bridges, stuff like that. Putting down rocks. They've done a great job, and they've done a lot of work here in the Catskills, and I appreciate their work. I also heard about this. I don't know if you guys heard about this, that the improved the trail rail access in Shandaken. Have you heard about that?
Nope.
Okay, so excellent. So Ulster County received nearly $4 million for an improved trail access in Shandaken. An executive in Ulster County received $3.96 million from New York State to convert 2.5 miles of the old Ulster and Delaware Railroad corridor to a multi-use trail with pedestrian bridges. The funding will be used to promote environmental friendly modes of travel on the corridor from the High Mount Bel Air Beach to the town of Shandaken. It says to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and once completed, the project will improve connectivity, air quality, and public access. So that'll be some cool stuff. I remember doing some bushwhacks behind there, and that is a pretty unique area.
Yes, it is.
And it's very historic. So that'll be some really cool stuff, especially with the great Delaware and Ulster Railroad that brought basically America alive.
Really. Yeah, it really connected the Catskills for sure.
All right. So we're going to do a quick little session of Catskills history. You guys down with that?
Yes.
Okay. So I read these books all the time, and I found a cool little two paragraph thing from John Burroughs' book called In the Catskills. It's a little essay that he wrote. So this is taken from his book. Time for fence building is usually between seed time and harvest, May and June, or in the fall after the crops are gathered. The work has its picturesque features of the prying rocks, supple forms of climbing or swinging from the end of great levers, or the blasting of rocks with powder, the hauling of them into position with oxen and horses, or with both, the picking of stone from the greenswald, the bending, athletic forms of the wall layers, the snug new fence creeping slowly up the hill or across the field, absorbing the windrow of loose stones, and, when the work is done, much ground reclaimed, the plow in the grass, and the strong barrier erected. It is a common complaint that the farm and farm life are not appreciated by our people. We long for the more elegant pursuits or ways and fashions of the town, but the farmer has the most sane and natural occupation and ought to be found a life sweeter, if less highly seasoned than any other. He alone, strictly speaking, has a home. How can a man take root and thrive without land? He writes his history upon his field. How many ties, how many resources he has, his friendship with his cattle, his team, his dog, his trees, the satisfaction in his growing crops, in his improved fields, his intimacy with nature, with bird and beast, and with the quickening of elemental forces, his cooperation with the clouds, the sun, the seasons, heat, wind, rain, and frost. Nothing will take various social distempers, which the city and artificial life breed out of man farming, like direct and loving contact with the soil. It draws out the poison, humbles him, teaches him patience and reverence, and restores proper tone in this system. Cool stuff. And we can relate to these stone walls all over the Catskills, very historic markers all over the Catskills. You guys probably run into them all the time when you're doing your awesome hikes and bushwhacks that you always do.
We still have some on our property.
Yes.
And that's a historic route, because that connected Stamford and then Stamford Oneonta to Roxbury, right? And we're down in Roxbury, right?
Yeah. If the, current rail trail, Catskill Scenic Rail Trail, it ends about 5 miles from our house. If it were to continue, it would come right by our home. Our property borders that actual railroad bed.
Oh, wow. That's pretty neat.
And it heads from Bloomville into East Meredith as it goes by us.
Wow, that's crazy. You can still see remnants from the old trail?
Oh, yes, we can. Oh, wow. For certain. One of the most interesting things is that we have an old creamery about a half a mile from us. And one of the interesting things to me, anyway, is walking on the railroad track when we first moved here, I saw something shimmering, and it was a pile of broken milk bottles because they couldn't take a chance on their milk, you know, being placed in a cracked or broken, chipped milk bottle. And so they had a bottle dump. Very near the creamery, where they just threw the bottles out and they smashed them hard. So yeah. They were completely broken. And there is a significantly large number of them.
Wow. Of course, that's abandoned, right?
Yes, it is.
Have you found any history of when it was actually ended?
No, I actually have not looked into that, but my understanding is that the train was still coming through here in the 50s and possibly even through the 60s.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Awesome stuff. I love the history in the Catskills. It never ends. It seriously never ends.
No.
All right, so I'd like to welcome my guests of the night to the show, Laurie and Tom Rankin.
Let's go.
Laurie and Tom are longtime Catskill hikers, natives. Are you guys from here?
I am.
I was mostly raised in the Hudson Valley, and I'm a redneck in training, as I call it now.
Well, I wouldn't say that, but yeah, Catskill native hikers, hikers around the East Coast and pretty much everywhere, and Fire Tower advocates, which is great. Fire Tower leaders, I would say, of New York State. So very big influence on the Fire Tower projects we have here. So welcome, Tom and Laurie. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah. So why don't you guys give a little background on yourself real quick? How about Laurie? We'll go with you first.
So I was actually born and raised just outside of Margaretville, where my father was the observer at Balsam Lake Mountain Fire Tower. So he had to work every weekend. And as a young girl, when I was attending school, was the only time that Dad had a day off. So on a weekend, we often went to work with him. And that was quite common for most of the observers' families, actually, to join them for a period of time on the mountain. So I was very quickly introduced to the forest as a child and mountaintop views. And, you know, if there was anything that an observer did, an observer was a steward of the land and took great care of it. And so that was kind of impressed upon me as a youngster. And I didn't really begin a passion for myself as hiking and spending time in the forest until after I had kids. And then I couldn't wait to show them the same things that my dad had shown me. And so I did a lot of camping with my kids. And once they graduated from high school, then I really decided I needed something to do to fill my time. And that was when I set my sights on climbing those Catskill Mountains that I had been looking at for years from Balsam Lake. And so began my peak bagging career. And along with hiking the trails and checking off lists, I also was keenly aware of all that went on behind the scenes to make the trails stay in good shape, to clean up the trash, et cetera. So I also found out all of the different opportunities that were out there and manners in which I could help. And so it didn't take me long to start doing things like joining the 3500 Club for their trail maintenance weekends, to do litter pickup, to sit on the board of directors. Those kinds of things came pretty quickly after I started hiking. And I'm still doing that today in whatever capacity steps across my desk. I have a hard time saying no, Tom says.
Yeah.
So I am still very involved both in the Catskills and the Adirondacks, and certainly very involved with fire towers. Currently president of the Adirondack 46ers. I am a trailhead steward in both the Catskills and in the Adirondacks. I do litter pickup or trail maintenance in both locations whenever I can. And I am the New York State Director for the Forest Fire Lookout Association, which I think we'll talk a bit about later. And that has me involved in fire towers throughout the state. And I get to hike sometimes. Tom and I are still pursuing lists, which I'm pleased to do. And we also get to introduce our grandchildren to the hiking world.
Wow. That is an amazing background. I didn't know you were 46er president.
Yes.
Wow. Well, then I'll have to ask you a question afterwards.
Uh-oh. Okay.
nothing vague. So, Tom, what about you, sir?
Well, I was born in Western Pennsylvania. I've always lived near the woods. I guess I didn't live in the woods like Laurie did. But
same.
My parents moved us out to the Hudson Valley when I was young, and I spent the rest of my time growing up there. After college, I worked for IBM for 40 years, and then they asked me to come back part-time, so now I've been back for about 8 months.
Oh, yeah, I remember you telling me that. Yep, cool.
So that's keeping me, I'll say, half busy. I started hiking in the late 90s, and looking at some of the things I've accomplished now, I guess I'm amazed at what I've accomplished. Not patting myself on the back, but when I first heard about people like 46ers, I thought, oh, those people must be like marathon runners or, you know, people like that. And those winter 46ers, those are just crazy people, you know. But
yep.
I just kept going and kept getting the gear and the experience and conditioning and so forth. And before I knew it, I was one of those crazy people.
You're also former 3500 president, correct?
Yes, I became president of the club around 2014. I'd have to do the math in my head, but there's been several presidents after me now, suffice it to say. That gig was I guess, I liked some of it and I didn't like some of it, right? I'm more of a doer than a politician.
Same.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't need to talk much about that, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. It's all good. So excellent. And you are you basically by Laurie's side all the time with her doing all this stuff? You're just like, I'll help you out any way possible?
Mostly. I'm not actually on the stewards programs. Laurie's doing that herself.
But you're always there. I always see you there.
He is my support staff for sure.
And, yes, I'm her webmaster.
And he is definitely the webmaster of everything.
Nice. Yes. And I really do thank both of you for what you do, number one. And number two, for Tom, you are a very good poster on the Aspirant 3500 members. It's really good stuff and really helpful stuff that'll inspire people to do the right thing and to take the right path and stuff like that. So I love seeing your stuff, and it's great.
That's good. Thank you.
Yeah. So when did you guys start hiking together? When did you start hiking in the Catskills, really? I mean, Laurie, you were right off the bat, basically.
Yeah. Yeah.
I already mentioned the late 90s, but
okay.
We were first started hiking together when we weren't together.
Yep.
We did a hike to Levitt.
A club hike.
Yeah. We were both married to other people. And eventually we weren't married to those people. And I bumped into her at the Denning Trailhead. And she was actually, we weren't even supposed to hike together, but we ended up hiking together for a while. And we actually split up that day because she was with another person finishing a different list, I guess. And I met some guys from Albany, and we did Lone and Rocky, which we just did recently.
Nice.
So we started chatting online. And then I made her what I call a foolish bet, but it turned out good. I'll explain.
Well, I've got to back this up before we go to the bet and say that I was I was a hike leader at the time for the club, and he signed up for one of my hikes, and that's where there was a bet.
That was after the bet was won or lost. Anyway. At least that's how I remember it. I might be wrong because there's a woman.
Of course.
So I bet her that the Patriots would lose the Super Bowl, which, looking back on it now, is pretty much always a bad idea. And I don't even remember who they were playing, but the winner had to pay for a weekend in the Adirondacks, and this was wintertime. So I lost, but, you know, I got a wife out of the deal eventually.
Aww.
Our first true date was Colden. It was about 10 below zero. And we hiked around from the backside to make it more interesting, I guess. So even though it was 10 below zero, I still tell people it was a hot date.
That's because I was in good shape back then, and we were breaking trail and I had him sweating.
Oh, wow.
Well, I did produce some of my magic, as she calls it. We were just about to get to
Marcy Dam,
and I heard chickadees tweeting or chirping or whatever they do. And I said, "Oh, let's get out some snacks, some morsels. They'll eat right out of our hand." And she's like, "No way, that's impossible." So, sure enough, I have a picture of her feeding the chickadees out of her hand.
Wow.
And she thought I had magic powers from that point on. And our wedding invitation has that same photograph on there. And we ended up getting married on top of Whiteface. And just a couple of days ago, well, backed the bus up 15 years.
Yeah.
But it's been a lot of views and a lot of brews and a lot of good times.
Yeah, I remember seeing that picture online, and that was fantastic.
Yeah.
I was just like, oh, man. Did you guys, of course, you probably hiked up, correct?
No, we didn't want to risk twisting an ankle and not making it to the top, you know?
Right. Or looking at the top, the pictures be like all sweaty.
Yes.
Yes. A lot of people hiked. Some people drove, you know, it was a collection of friends and family and hikers and, you know.
Our wedding attire was our 46er t-shirts, though.
Yes. Sweet. So cool. That is so cool. I love the smiles. It's so good. Yeah. It's so cute. Awesome. Thank you. That was fantastic. So you guys are, say, your peak baggers. So what have you accomplished? Of course, your 3,500ers, 46ers. What else?
Well, we've done the winter 115 as well as the summer 115, which is all the 4,000 footers in the entire Northeast. We've done the Catskill 100 highest together, then the Saranac Sixer,
the New England Lake 100 Placid highest. Niner,
the New England 100 highest. Let's just say we have over 100 patches. I can't remember what all of them are offhand.
Wow. You got to be kidding me.
No, we actually have found that it really does inspire us in many ways to have a list. It also gives us a reason to explore new areas. Of course, much of what we have done is centered around New York State in the Northeast, but we've also done some state high pointing. I believe we're up to 26.
We're over 30.
Oh, sorry, 30, 31. I forgot our last trip, state high points. And so we do a little exploring around other parts of the United States as well.
What's the highest point have you been, your highest elevation?
14,000 footers out in Colorado would be the highest.
Crazy.
So fun.
Yeah. Wow. Excellent. So you guys are crazy all over the place. I didn't know that you guys went all over the place. So that's awesome. 30 out of what, 49? Are you guys doing all 50 states?
We'll never do all 50.
Nah, we're getting a little, we're aging out of some of those.
I don't think so. You guys are like flying all over the mountains. You guys are doing so much hikes. I mean, were a lot of these patches and stuff after you guys retired when you had more time, or you guys just do this on the weekend? Like everybody I know, everybody does it on the weekend somehow.
Well, we actually don't hike as much on weekends now, especially when lots of people were out during COVID.
But yes, we did do a lot of these while we were working.
Some of them are fairly easy to acquire. Some of them aren't, obviously, you know. There's some you can get in a day, and there's some that takes months or years.
I would also very honestly say that we have truly been blessed with good health. And so sick leave at work is sometimes, utilized for the 3,000 foot virus. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that.
I will be.
Well, you know, you kind of, you wake up in the morning and you can't really put your finger on what's not right, but you're not feeling well. And you know, the only way to cure that is to phone work and say, I'm sorry, I will not be in today. I'm not feeling well. And then you must climb somewhere above 3,000 feet. And that's the cure. So
I think I'll be the only one in my job that would use that. So I don't know if that'll go well with them.
Yeah.
I could use my search and rescue volunteer excuse.
There, I'm just there, like, you
oh,
go.
Sorry. I gotta go on a rescue. Somebody called me. I'm sorry.
That's right.
That's important.
Wow. You guys are like, I knew you guys did a lot, but I can't accumulate in my mind of how you guys get up to the, like the whites on a weekend and do like three or four. And then it's just like coordinating everything is just it hurts my brain. I just can't believe some people like from here have done that, and from other places as well. That's just crazy.
Well, we usually make that a multi-day trip. I mean, we almost never go even to the Adirondacks for just a day, and certainly not the whites.
We would actually, though, over time we made a lot of friends in New England, and oftentimes we would go and stay with them. And we would actually leave work on a Friday and drive up there. We learned the best routes to go. And we would hike on Saturday and Sunday and come home Sunday. We did a lot of the Vermont Peaks coming back on a Sunday afternoon. So we were like, we would be like halfway there driving and then climb and then halfway on home, you know, the other half home. So it did take some logistics and planning, but we actually like that kind of stuff.
And there were some failures too, especially in the winter.
Oh yeah.
When you wake up and it's 10 degrees below zero in Maine and the wind is howling and the snow is blowing, sometimes the best thing to do is either nothing or just go home.
Yeah. Wow. You guys probably got some crazy story and we're going to save that.
Okay.
So what's your favorite hike in the Catskills? Just off the top of your head.
I can tell you what mine is, and that is it's the last mountain I was on. And it's that way every time. To me, it never gets old being out there. We were at Balsam Lake stewarding on Monday. We got to see a bear on the way up. He was getting a drink out of the spring. We got to see a number of really wonderful visitors. Fantastic views from the fire tower on Monday. And that was just an absolutely fabulous hike. Been there hundreds of times and it just simply does not get old.
I agree. Tom, you?
I'm kind of like that. I tell people when Laurie isn't listening, my favorite mountain is Hunter, but when she is listening, it's Balsam Lake. And Hunter has views in every direction. You know, it's in the middle of the Catskills, you know, no matter where you can see a Catskill mountain. Balsam Lake is different because it's right on the edge of the high peak. So you look in one direction and there's a lot of the high peak spread out right in front of you. But if you turn around, there's none. And it's just rolling hills behind you. So it has that perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I gave you two answers.
Nice. Hey, Hunter, I got to admit, a lot of people underestimate the fire tower view from Hunter. And you're right. It gives you so many high peaks views. And that look down Spruceton Valley when you're on the sunset is one of the unbeatable places for a sunset.
And I agree.
I've got to go. I seriously, every year I say I got to go up with you guys to light into the fire towers to see that up there. I got to go at night. But I mean, I've been, when that happened, I was at Mount U. I wasn't in the fire tower, but, you know, and then we got to see, we went to Giant Ledge, but we got to see Overlook.
Yeah.
Tremper, and I don't know, you can't see Red Hill, but we got overlooking Tremper. Was pretty cool. So
yeah.
I got to go up with you guys to that, because that's a cool, I admit, that's an amazing event.
Yes, we like that. I'll tell you, the one of our favorites though truly is to go to Hunter for the sunset, because if you go up on the Devil's Path and you go up in the daylight, you enjoy the sunset, maybe you have a snack and a cold beverage while you're enjoying the sunset, and then you go back down Becker Hollow, that section of 214 on the road walk back to your car is complete dark skies. There are there's no houses there, there's no streetlights there. So when you do that sunset on a clear evening, you also can really hit some dark skies and see beautiful stars.
Interesting. It's not as long as the descent down to Spruceton as well.
Yeah.
Spruceton, a couple 4 miles. So, and then Becker Hollow, even though it's steep, it's still only like 2 miles of down.
That's correct.
It's a good point. I'll have to go to Notch Lake and get some nighttime pictures there.
Yes.
I never thought of that, because you're right in between both of the mountains. So it's massively dark.
Yes.
Cool.
Very nice.
Excellent. So with all your hiking experience, I always ask people this because they come up with amazing stories, and I've never had a time of where I've been a close call. Have you guys ever had close calls while out on the trail?
I have two that come to mind. When you told me you were going to ask us this question, one that came to my mind was an Adirondack hike. When Tom and I were doing our winters, we were often staying at a small B&B in Newcomb, and we arrived one evening quite late, and we did not tell the owners of the B&B what our plans were for the next day because we had arrived so late. The next morning, we left very early, And it was very cold. It was below zero. And we drove into Upper Works, and our goal for the day was Cliff Mountain. And because it was so cold and it was just the two of us, you know, you kind of, when you start out on one of those cold days, you have to get the right layering of clothes, the right pace so that you're warm enough, but you're not too warm. And Tom and I were struggling a little bit as we were getting started to get to that space. And about that time, Tom said, "Hear the robins singing." And I immediately thought, "Oh my goodness, hear the robins singing in February. It's below zero. He is very hypothermic. I've got to try to convince him to get out of here." And then as I was trying to decide how to do that, I heard the robins singing. And in fact, it was a year when there were a number of mountain ashberries, and robins had stayed to eat them. These robins were fluffed up like chicken size. And they were singing all around.
We have pictures to prove it.
So we continued on our trek to Cliff Mountain. That was slow going because of the cold. There was deep snows as we climbed. And finally, Tom says, "Oh, we're here at last." And it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon by then. And we'd been on the trail since 6 a.m. And I said, "No, we're not. We're on the fault summit. We still have to get to the real summit." And we decided to turn back.
Wow.
And we turned back with our heads down, dejected. It was dark, of course, by 5 o'clock. It's pitch black. We still had miles to go. At one point, you know, we're both thinking, why do we want to do this terrible nonsense of winter 46ing? And we got back out to the car, looked up and saw these magnificent stars. And we said, okay, all's right with the world again. We started down the Upper Works Road and soon saw headlights coming our way, which is unusual. And then flashing lights came on. And it turned out to be the forest ranger. And he rolled down his window, and Tom rolled down the window, and he said, "Are you Tom Rankin?" We immediately thought, "Oh my gosh, something's happened at home." And he said, Tom said, "Well, yes, why?" And he said, "Well, because the people from the B&B, because you weren't back and it was so cold, called me to come out and look for you." So the ranger was very glad he did not have to get out of his warm truck. And Tom and I were very glad that the people at the B&B cared enough to do something like that, and that the ranger cared enough to come out. So that was somewhat of a close call, just because of the way our minds were thinking. But I don't know that we've really had close calls other than that.
There's been one or two times when we were out in the winter and walking along a ledge and hoping we didn't fall over, you know, but I don't know if that was quite anything that we would have died if we had plunged over, you know.
Wow.
No, I'm
injuries
saying,
or anything?
I'm saying that no, I don't think anything like that has ever been too scary, but let's see.
Well, perhaps when we were climbing in Maine to Saddleback Mountain and Sugarloaf Mountain, and
Saddleback and the Horn, right?
No, it was the Sugarloaf Ski Center.
I'm sure, I forgot what the other one's called. It starts with an A, right?
No, this was Sugarloaf. I know what she means.
Spalding. That was the one. Sugarloaf, Spalding.
They let us go up the ski slopes. And that's fine until you get to tree line, and the winds were just crazy. So we almost ran across the top of the summit back to tree line and went over to Spalding and came back. And on the way back, the winds were even worse, but thank God there was like an abandoned building up there. We ducked in for a while, but one of our hiking partners noticed that Laurie was getting frostbite on her face.
Oh, wow.
They're actually putting their hands on her face, you know. The laying on of hands, I guess.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Warm her face up.
Yeah.
And it was a good thing that building was there, because we still had a long way to go to get to the other side of the tree line.
Yeah, we were thankful that day that was there, that shelter.
And something blew away, right?
Oh, Nicole's snowshoe blew off.
Yeah, it was so good. Snowshoe blew right off.
I caught it as it flew by. And the reason
the wind blew it?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And wow. the reason why my face was so bad was that I was wearing goggles that had gotten all fogged. You have to be completely covered, of course, in that kind of weather. And my goggles had gotten all fogged over, so I couldn't see. They just froze right over. And so I had pulled them up so I could see that last little bit across the summit. And instantly I had frozen, you know, eyelashes and eyebrows and everything because I'd had moisture. And that's why they immediately covered my face to warm it when I got in. So that was kind of a close call.
I guess I believe it or not, on Little Cascade, if you want to call him little, right? He's 4,000 footer, but people think Cascade is very easy. Well, I went up in the winter, and again, it was an extremely windy day. A tree fell over while I was hiking up the trail. It didn't come anywhere near me, but it kind of spooked me, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got above tree line, the wind was just so bad I had to crawl to the top. And my snowshoes were actually acting like sails, right? They were dragging my feet. You know, I could almost not control my feet. I had to keep my snowshoes like in the lee of the wind. And basically I was like flitting from boulder to boulder and ducking under cover. Right? Well, I finally got out of there and I decided, all right, I'll go over to Porter. It's mostly in the trees, right? So I got over to Porter, no problem. And then coming back, there was a tree that wasn't across the trail 2 minutes ago. It was across the trail now, a big ass tree, pardon my French. Mm-hmm. And so I had just missed that blowdown. But again, yeah, those... it you know, it wasn't something that was going to take me out, but thankfully it missed me.
Yeah, those times when you're in the wind and you can hear those trees and you're just like, is this going to crack or not? You're just always looking up and it's very scary. Like I haven't dealt with that stuff before. I've never, which I want to though. I am one of those guys that likes to go out in the middle of dead winter at -5 degrees and 25 degrees below zero. And just, it's just, I don't know. It's maybe it makes you feel alive, more alive. So I got to get up to the Adirondacks. Every story that everybody says that they're close calls or they've had crazy times have been above treeline in the Adirondacks.
Yes, that is one thing we don't have in the Catskills is that above treeline experience. But I think the Catskills is a wonderful training ground for so much in terms of hiking. I mean, we have some really rugged trails. We also have some significant elevation gains to deal with. And depending upon how you put things together, some really long, lengthy hikes.
And our rocks are slipperier.
Oh, yes. The footing is difficult in the Catskills. So I think you learn a lot in the Catskills with the exceptions of that above tree line experience.
Yeah. So for my birthday, my 26th birthday, I'm going to do, hopefully, if it's all goes well, Phelps and Marcy.
Oh, nice.
Is what I want to do. I'm going to camp at Marcy Dam or around there on a Tuesday, not on the weekend.
Yeah.
So I'll get a spot at least and then do Phelps and then Marcy, or maybe Marcy then Phelps, just in case. I just want to summit Marcy. So
yeah, take the best weather day. That's how you decide on Marcy.
That's what everybody told me. And the thing is like, you know, I might have to use that 3,000 feet elevation excuse.
Yes, that's a possibility, but you will feel much better once you get above 3,000. The other thing that you'll see in several places is, you know, you expect those severe, quick weather changes when you're above tree line. And it truly does happen. And, you know, you always want to have an eye to the weather and the possibility of it changing when you're above tree line, because it comes fast.
Yeah. And that's the thing with the Northeast is it's, I think a lot of people underestimate our weather up here.
I believe so. Yes.
And once you get above tree line, it's like nothing else. And they're like, oh, it's only, you know, 5,000 feet. It's not a 12,000 footer, but we can get the same weather as those 12,000 footers.
That's right. And there's no trees to block that wind. There's no trees to block that precipitation. And your visibility just disappears instantly. And when those three things happen all together, you're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And Crazy stuff. Well, good. Thank you for those stories. So let's get into some fire tower talk. You guys are big into the fire towers in New York State, and you have helped a lot in New York State. And of course, the big boom in the past 3 years with the fire tower challenge coming up out of middle of nowhere. You guys have really helped and influenced a lot of people and volunteers. So let's get into some talk about the fire towers. When did you get into, you know, volunteering and doing stuff with the fire towers?
Well, I, again, my background is, of course, growing up as the observer's daughter. So Balsam Lake has been near and dear to my heart for many years. And I believe Tom and I have been up there 12 years.
Well, I've only been up, we started in 05.
Yeah.
So 17.
17 years. Oh, my, wow. The time flies. But we were just volunteers there at the fire tower to begin with. And then after a couple of years, I became the volunteer coordinator, coordinating all of the volunteers. We had 1 year where it was just ourselves, another couple, and one other gentleman. And that's all we had for the whole year.
Wow.
A lot of people are unaware that the Catskill Fire Tower project started in the late 1990s, based upon the fact that the towers were decommissioned, most of them, in the 70s, and then they were just abandoned and left to the elements. And if you or I stood on top of a mountain for 20 years in the weather that we get in the Catskills, you'd begin to deteriorate as well. And local people who had looked at these fire towers as, you know, protectors of their communities and historic icons, they were very saddened by that. And so they started in each local community to say, hey, what can we do to save these towers? And each local group for the five fire towers, that being Balsam Lake, Red Hill, Hunter, Tremper, and Overlook, they all had different strengths in their local communities. So some people, had people who made donations. Some people had steel workers. For example, at Balsam Lake, we had steel workers who made a stainless steel roof for the tower. Oh, wow. We had people who held concerts and raised money that way, or spaghetti dinners, or they sold paintings. You know, whatever each of these grassroots organizations could do to raise funds to restore and repair these towers. And of course, the towers are owned by the state of New York and managed by the DEC. So they had to get the DEC agreeable and amenable to these restorations. The Catskill Center at the time was suggesting that we would have more power if all five fire towers came together in some manner, as opposed to each of the separate five. So the Catskill Fire Tower Project was born, and eventually all five fire towers were in fact restored, reopened to the public. And the long range goal, of course, is to keep them all maintained and open, and to man them with volunteers on weekends from Memorial Day through Columbus Day. And those volunteer stewards have numbered in the hundreds since they reopened. And they continue to be out there today, giving up their time hiking and family time and meeting and greeting the visitors. And they provide historical interpretation. They provide information on Leave No Trace, where the nearest pizza place is. Just all kinds of information that passes. And because of the presence of those stewards, I think all five of those mountains have seen fewer effects than some of the other mountains have with the increase in users.
Of course. Yeah, definitely. The stewards anywhere in the Catskills, anywhere in the state, anywhere in the United States are a blessing, because they help out so much. Just even like I just had a talk with Alan Villa on here. And if you can influence, he says, you know, 25%. I'm like, if you can influence 1 to 5%, that is a huge impact.
Yes.
Because those 1 to 5% could pass it on to another person. And then it's a snowball effect. It's just so great. And I love, we went up to Balsam Lake one time and Colleen was up there.
Okay.
I think it was Colleen. She was former president of the club.
Uh-huh.
and she was very nice. And then we went up to Tremper one time on the weekend, and Matt Atchison was up there. He was very cool.
Yeah.
There's two puppies.
Yeah.
And of course there's Charlie and Alan, which I've met up there. And Charlie is, I don't even know what to say about Charlie. He's, he's the man. So,
yeah. And before him, because the program's been going so long, before him, you had Dick Voloshin up there. And, you know, it's just, like I said, it's an incredibly successful program now going over 20 years, all volunteers. And it's changed generations now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's great. So do you, with the Fire Tower history, you said, the late 90s is when they were restored.
Yes. I think I know Balsam Lake reopened in 2000, and I want to say Tremper 2001 as the last one, I think.
So when was the first like fire tower? Do you know when the first fire tower was put up in Catskills?
Yes. It was the very first one was on Balsam Lake. It was in 1887, and it was a wooden tower. And it was put up by the Balsam Lake Club to protect their forestry resources so that their lake was not affected by, say, silting up because, you know, trees were burned or whatever, because their fisheries were extremely important to them.
And when you say the first in the Catskills, it's definitely the first site in New York and maybe even the entire country.
For Balsam Lake?
We don't know of any older offhand.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Amazing.
There's some towers in cities that were like meant to look for house fires, but as far as forest fire lookouts go, it's the oldest one we know of.
Wow. And what made them choose Balsam Lake? Why not Graham or Double Top? Was it just because they had the perfect spot to throw up a fire tower?
Well, they were probably closer to Balsam Lake, of course, is pretty close to Balsam Lake Mountain.
True.
So, and they probably figured, well, it's almost as high. And as I mentioned, it looks out over a great swath of land, if you, so to speak, turn around from the high peaks. I mean, we estimate we can see like 50 miles in any given direction from up there. So wow. The observer would have quite a view.
I also think we're always learning something new all the time. And in 2019 was the centennial of this current steel tower. And while doing some research for that centennial, we were given a number of old documents from the Balsam Lake Club. And I believe part of the reason for it being on Balsam Lake was simply the ease of someone walking up there to check on it, because there weren't trails and roads back then. Mm-hmm. And I think it was easier to get to that summit than it was to say get to to Graham or Double Top.
Okay, cool. That's wicked. Wow, first fire tower like almost ever. I wonder if that's true. If so, that's incredible. So when did your father go up to? When was he not a steward? He was a forest ranger up there, or just an observer?
So that's kind of a common misconception. The people who worked in the fire towers were fire tower observers. It was actually a position within the conservation department at the time. And then their bosses were the forest rangers. And okay. The forest rangers actually usually were in charge of several different fire towers. They were the people who were on the ground, so to speak, in the valley. So that when the fire tower observers would see smoke, they would report to the ranger, and the ranger was the one who would then get the resources there to put the fire out, either nice. local fire departments or other rangers or whatever.
Nice. So what period was your father up there?
My dad was on Balsam Lake from 1958 to 1972. He was the last wow. full-time observer there. After 1972, it was only manned part-time during times of high fire danger.
Oh, wow. Awesome. That's crazy. Interesting. So the past couple of years, we know that the Fire Tower Challenge has made an insane amount of, brought a crazy amount of people here up to the Catskills and to the Adirondacks and stuff like that. I mean, I could remember going up to the fire tower and like on Tremper and being alone in 2000, 16, I think I went for the first time, and being alone the whole day. Now, you can go up there sometime and get a little privacy, but here and there, but the other fire towers, forget about it. How have you handled this crazy uproar in the past couple of years? I mean, it just didn't go from 1 to 15. It went to 1 to 200, 300, 400, like that. It was crazy.
Yes. I can only really speak for Balsam Lake, but I can also only imagine the numbers that they have had and how they manage it at Overlook and Hunter. We used to see, on average, maybe we would see for the days when we are up there stewarding, we used to see maybe 30 or 40 people on a really busy day. We might get up to 50. And then in 2019, the first Catskill Fire Tower Challenge came, and it came with all kinds of prizes. There were bells and whistles. You could get license plates and patches and pins and all kinds of things. And we very quickly went to seeing doubling those numbers. So we were seeing up to 60 people a day. And some cases on nice days, even more than that. One of the first things that we did at Balsam Lake was we actually had to ask for more volunteers and for our current volunteers to staff more often. So it usually we would have one person on the ground and one person up in the fire tower. We were actually finding that a third volunteer was very helpful. Just to manage dealing with that many people. That was from the volunteer standpoint. And then 2020 came next with COVID. and then our numbers soared even higher. And a couple of the big things that really, really happened was the impact on the natural environment and the historical structures. You can't suddenly just start adding that many more people and not find an impact. And so our trails were eroding. We have some places where our trails were very wet, and people were widening the trails significantly to get around the wet areas.
Well, one place there was a go around. It was so bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's right after Graham, I'm guessing, right? Right after the...
There's a big flat spot at 3,500 feet on our trail.
Yes.
And it's always muddy, even in dry times. So people go around it. And then in wet times, even that trail got muddy. So they went around that trail too.
Yeah. And we also, we were finding there's more wear and tear, of course, on the fire tower structure itself, where the stairs are just seeing double, in some cases, triple the traffic. And so the boards are not lasting as long as they once did. We're also seeing that, especially around the summit area, the summit of Balsam Lake is over 3,700 feet, and it's a pretty fragile summit. Bedrock is very close. And because there were just so many people, the groups that used to sit, three or four places in the summit, there just wasn't room enough for them. So now we're looking at groups of perhaps, 10 different groups at a time. And so they began to spread out from the clearing into the forest and have more of an impact there. And, that impact takes many years to heal. So there were significant impacts seen by all of the increase in visitors.
Not to mention the parking lots were overflowing in many places.
Yeah.
Led to people parking on the road or parking where they in someone's driveway, And
yeah,
we haven't had anybody towed away from Balsam Lake that I know of, but I've heard about more and more places where they're ticketing and towing people away because instead of going somewhere else, they just park on the road, mm-hmm. Double park or do other ridiculous things.
Yeah.
Yeah. At Balsam Lake, for example, it's a small, narrow town road. And when you park cars on both sides of the road, there's limited sight distance there because it's kind of at the top of the hill. And B, you have large emergency vehicles like fire trucks and ambulances that simply can't get through. So that's a big thing, as is the the restroom facilities and or lack thereof.
Yeah.
So
I was going to say the state didn't take any of this into account when they made these challenges, you know?
Oh yeah. It stinks. And I remember being with you, Laurie, with the presentation about it, and it was tough. But you know, the positive, let's break off the negative and go to the positive. Yes. People fell in love with the Catskills when they go up to that first fire tower and they see that. And Balsam Lake is to me one of the, besides Overlook, is a perfect starter because easy way to get up there, and it brings you through different forests where you don't get that Balsam Forest up in Overlook. You do get it in Hunter, but Balsam Lake is an absolute stunning place. So bringing these people, I mean, huge impacts, a huge amount of people, but they fell in love with the Catskills, and you guys are there to steward them and teach them that, hey, you know, you do this, do that and stuff like that. And that'll, like you said, influence them to love the Catskills. So.
And I totally agree. I totally agree with that. While I mentioned the negative impacts from that, I think it has been a fabulous opportunity for us to be able to have so many new people that they're very frank and honest in saying they don't know what they're doing or
they don't have a map. Or, you know.
Yes. And like, I remember this one woman in particular, she came into the Balsam Lake clearing. She appeared to be in very good physical condition. It was a very hot day. She had absolutely no gear or equipment with her. And the first thing she said was, "Oh my gosh, that is the longest mile and a half I've ever been on." And I said, "Ma'am, what made you think it was a mile and a half to get here?" And she said, "Well, the sign says it's 3 miles." And so she assumed the trail signs meant there and back, a round trip.
Which, you know, none of them ever do.
So it's very simple assumptions that those of us who have been doing this for a long time know, and these new people didn't know. And so we've really found that, like I said, we've added some volunteers so that we have, sometimes we have as many as 4 volunteers at a time, so that we can all really have a conversation with these people because they're hungry for the knowledge. They want to do it the right way.
So we've run into people who said, we had a difficult time figuring out what they were talking about, where they're coming from and where they're going. We finally, we realized that they thought they were on Balsam, not Balsam Lake. But the opposite problem too, we were on Balsam once and somebody asked us, how far was it to the fire tower? They said, well, it's about 7 miles, but you can't really get there from here, you know?
Yeah. You got 3 different Balsams in the Catskills.
Right. Those, and there's even a sign, unfortunately, that says Balsam Mountain toward Balsam Lake, that the state has never fixed it.
Yeah. You
know? Yes, that's true, actually. And then I wonder, it stinks because people sign it. If you sign into the register, it says Balsam Lake Forest at the top, doesn't it?
I do believe it does, yes.
Yeah, so.
I mean, had people at that parking lot, even though there's a big arrow to the left that says fire tower, have walked out of the parking lot, out the back of the parking lot and up the other side of the mountain, not the other, the different Drybook, mountain. Drybook, yeah, they walked Ridge. Up Drybook Ridge and went who knows how far before they realized, no, we're on the wrong trail.
Oh, we yeah.
Back up to the tower, and then some of them have actually admitted this to us, which we find funny, but not
so. They in the parking area, they went north instead of going across the road, right?
Right, right. Yes. They don't realize they have to cross the road.
Yeah.
Even though there's a big arrow there.
Oh, man. Well, I mean, a lot of things, you know, is they get that view. I don't think they realize how amazing those views are on the fire towers. It's absolutely stunning. And all these fire towers have been fantastic views. I mean, when the people see that view, they get hooked, and then it leads to so much more, which is great. I mean, to be honest, I used to be one of those guys that, even though I haven't been at it as long as you guys, but you know, like 2 or 3 years into it, I'm just like, I don't want anybody to come here.
Yeah.
This is my place, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But then getting in with the club, getting in with volunteering and stuff, you have that impact to push people in the right direction.
Yeah.
And they, mm-hmm. they could take it or leave it, but most people take it.
Yes, they do.
Which is awesome.
Yes.
Yep.
And I, like I said, I was a greedy little guy. I'm just like, this is my area. I don't want people to know about this. But being a volunteer has changed my perspective on that completely.
Yeah.
And I can see why you guys do so much volunteering, because it is so much fun. And I wish I had the time. I wish I had, my job would let me have 4 days off a week or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you'll get to that point someday in your life.
I can't wait. Maybe, maybe. So what, let's, we really didn't go over the FFLA, the Forest Fire. What is it again?
So it's the Forest Fire Lookout Association.
Lookout Association.
And again, it's a nationwide all volunteer group that was formed in 1990 to preserve and protect not just the fire tower structures, but also their history and their the persons who worked on them. And there are chapters throughout the state of New York, the United States, as well as Australia, Canada. There's lots of activity in terms of these fire tower geeks who love to protect fires, fire towers. And I'm not sure how many years I've been doing this now, but basically throughout the state of New York, we just try to support the work of already existing friends groups, or we try to work with whatever the owner may be of the fire tower to help them with whatever the needs might be. It might be restoration. It might be painting over graffiti. It might be encouraging the development of a new friends group, whatever their needs may be. The state of New York had over 100 fire towers at one point in time. Now, as of this past week, I believe our 73rd fire tower is now standing in the state.
Whoa.
So we still have quite a few, and there, some of them are private and you can't visit, but we just had a new one put up in Speculator this past weekend.
I remember seeing that. That's awesome.
Yeah. So the work continues. It continues with all volunteers. We with the FFLA hold several agreements with the state of New York for a variety of fire towers. And we have steward programs at some of those fire towers. At some, our agreement just calls for us to perhaps put new wood landing and step boards on, or perhaps to paint over graffiti. There's a wide variety of things we do, and we're able to do that because we have a fabulous group of volunteers who are willing to give of their time and help. It's a lot of fun. Like you said, it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun.
Yeah. The community coming together and the people coming together is absolutely awesome. I've been following that Speculator one.
Yeah.
For a while. And it's so cool. It's just wicked. And I'm super excited for Bramley Mount. I can't wait for that to get up there.
The Bramley Mountain group is working real hard, and we hope that's going up very soon.
And that there's one that's north of me that just opened up to the public. Is that the Berry Hill?
That's correct. Berry Hill in Chenango County. Yes.
Okay.
We do have the agreement with the state for that. And we have a great group of volunteers who are out there stewarding. And it's a tower that is accessible. So if we have somebody who has accessibility issues, we can actually get them right to the base of that tower.
Wow.
And the cabin, the observer's cabin, has also been restored and is open.
Sweet. I think I knew about that beforehand, but I knew it was closed to the public because I've read stuff online.
It was open up last year.
Are there any in Oxego County that we're going to open up?
No, there are not, unfortunately. No.
Okay.
The only thing that might happen there is if Leonard Hill were to be taken down and returned to Gilbert Lake State Park.
Oh, wow.
That's where it originally came from.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Yeah.
That would be pretty neat.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be great to have one smack dab in the middle of right outside of Oneonta and our rolling hills and stuff. I mean, what a great view that would be.
There was one outside of Skaneva's, Hooker Hill, but that's been taken down.
Oh, I've looked into Hooker Hill State Forest. I really want to go there.
Yep.
Excellent. So what's the, a lot of people, I've seen a lot of stuff online about crazy things they've seen at the fire towers. I remember one of my friends said she saw two people up in the cabin doing something, which is pretty scary. What is the craziest thing you guys ever seen at a fire tower?
Well, it was kind of late afternoon, and this train of young women came marching into the clearing. They were all wearing dresses. They all had hiking boots on, I must say. They did bring some gear with them. And at some point, we realized they had bathing suits under their dresses. And the first one in line said, "Where's Balsam Lake?" And I said, "Well, it's not at the top of the mountain, you know, it's down at the bottom of the mountain, and it's on private property." And after they stopped swearing, we explained to them that, you know, you're not allowed to go there. It's part of the Balsam Lake Club. So there's basically, you know, there's no swimming around here to be had, right? Unless you drove all the way to Alder Lake or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it turned out it was a bachelorette party, and they were all on a softball team together. So they decided to make the best of it. So they busted out their softballs and gloves and proceeded to play catch in the clearing, all the while wearing dresses, mind you. Mm-hmm. They didn't actually have a game, but then they busted out a whole bunch of food and adult beverages, shall we say. And they even had ice cream that they kept in a cold pack with CO2.
Yeah.
And they were just having a blast, you know. But at some point I realized, you know, it's getting late, girls. You know, do you have any headlamps? And the answer was no. So I said, You really got to leave soon because it's going to get dark and you don't have any way to see if it gets too dark and you're still on the trail. So we almost had to hustle them out of there. But, you know, it was nothing illegal, but it was unusual.
When they pulled the picture of freshly squeezed lime juice with ice and the bottle of gin out of their backpacks, I said, "Oh, these girls are very well organized, I must say."
Wow, that's pretty wicked. I wonder, did you ever ask them who thought of this thing for a bachelorette party?
The one girl just said, "I just missed on my research." You know, I mean, they were from quite a ways away and they had, you know, gotten the driving directions correct and everything except where that lake was.
Yeah. Oh, my God. That's pretty wicked, though. I mean, that's a hell of a bachelorette party.
Oh, yeah. You know, they were having a good time.
Instead of going out to the bars, you played softball on the top of a 3,700 foot mountain, the Catskills.
Yeah.
That's pretty sweet. Anything else?
I do have one crazy story, but I'm really hoping that your listeners don't recognize themselves. Tom and I were leading a 3,500 club hike to Hunter Mountain. And on the summit of the mountain, one of the hike participants asked me a question, which really made me step back a moment. It seems that he had lost his pet goldfish very recently. And he thought his final resting place should be the summit of Hunter Mountain. And so he asked me if it would be okay if he buried his goldfish up there. And I didn't really know how to answer that. I mean, I don't know how many times the goldfish had come to the summit of Hunter with him.
Yeah.
Why he wanted it there, I don't know. But that was kind of a bizarre question.
This was an adult?
It was an adult.
Okay. I think I could see a 9-year-old kid doing that, but not an adult. Oh, man. Interesting. Did you just be like leave no trace, but, you know, RIP.
Yes. I said, "Well, you know, I'm going to step over here, sir. You know, you can do whatever."
Should have had like a memorial. Everybody's singing.
Yes,
like,
we should have sang. Yes.
That is wicked. So, wow. A bunch of softball players playing softball on the mountain and a burial ground for a goldfish. That is definitely different. I love it. I can't say because I hike on the Tuesdays, I can't say I see any of that because it's always empty up there.
Yeah.
I mean, so I got to start volunteering sometime.
Yeah.
Up there. Excellent. So a big thing I like to do with my people I interview is, how can we help? How can the listeners help? How can we spread the word?
I think the most important thing that you can do is to, every chance you get, and I know you do a fabulous job of it actually, and that is to tell people how much fun it is to volunteer. There is just so much work to do. And there seems to be so many limited resources, and there is a way for everyone to get involved. Some people aren't comfortable chatting with others, so being a steward doesn't work well for them. But that person might be on the SAR team and be an extremely great team member. Or that person might be somebody who can go out and they can dig water bars all day and be very satisfied by doing that. There is an opportunity for everyone to volunteer. And you don't need to do it every weekend to make an impact. You can go out and volunteer once or twice a year, and it is helpful. So that's the best thing that you can do, is to keep pushing that spirit of volunteerism in everybody.
Yes, definitely. And I will keep doing that, because once again, I was one of those people that didn't want anybody to do anything with these mountains. Now I'm just like, if you're going to treat the mountains with respect, come on in.
Yes. Yes.
So excellent. I will post every volunteer thing I can on this show note right here then.
Thank you.
I will definitely do that. So, well, thank you for talking about the fire towers. I really appreciate it. Thank you for your help with the fire towers and your involvement. You guys are a huge impact on the fire towers in New York State, mostly in the Catskills, but New York State, definitely. I appreciate it.
Very well.
So let's talk about your I don't know what to call it, your organization or your patch. It's right. You guys got a patch for this called Views and Brews, correct?
Yeah, we've had our patch a lot longer than most of these Johnny Come Latelys, I must say. So back in 04, I had just finished my first round of the 35ers, and we went to we went to a beer bar to celebrate, and someone said, you know, I just earned the 3500 club patch, right? And I don't remember if someone handed me one at the top or not, but I'd earned it. So someone said, since we're sitting there drinking beer, there ought to be a patch for hiking and drinking beer. And I was like, I can make that happen. So it just like struck me, you know, it was like, yes, I can make that happen. So I started doing some research. There was actually a book about all the brew pubs in New York State at the time. It's way out of date now, of course, but
nice.
Got a webpage together, and we launched it at the TAP New York Beer Festival in April of that year.
2004?
Yeah.
Wow.
So the idea is you do a hike, and we have suggested hikes on the webpage, but you can do any hike you want of at least a mile. And typically the hike is nearby the brew pub, and then you go to the brew pub afterwards, typically, but you don't have to. I mean, you can go the night before, whatever. And that counts as one unit, right? And you need to do this, depending on what state you're trying to accomplish, you need to do it X number of times. So in New York, it's 30. 30 uh-huh. sounds like a lot, but there's 150 brew pubs in New York State now. So it's only 20%. If I made you go to all of them, that would be a pretty daunting task. So
yeah.
I cut it off. If a state gets too big, I just say, all right, 30. But for instance, Delaware, I think there's only like 6. So you could go down there and do the whole thing in a weekend if you wanted to.
Nice. How many states do you have?
Oh, let's see. There's at least a dozen. I mean, pretty much the entire Northeast, going down into Delaware, New Jersey, Pennsylvania. And the idea, it's kind of like little wildfires pop up sometimes, right? And forest fire. Well, we had someone say, I want to do Illinois. And I was like, great, you know, I'll help you. And she did like 99% of the work, right?
Oh, wow.
There's an Illinois chapter. And then someone else said, I've already done Alaska. Here you go. Here's all the information. And I was like, awesome, you know?
That's so cool.
Then I met a guy who does something very similar in New Mexico. And he basically already had the list that I wanted, right? We just had to, he doesn't distinguish between breweries and brew pubs. Mm-hmm. But so all we had to do was pick out which were which. And that list was pretty much done too. So I love it when people step up to the plate and say, I'd like to help you, right? So I had a guy help me with Vermont. I've had a lot of help with Maine.
Quebec.
We had three different Canadian chapters too. There's Prince Edward Island, Ontario, and Quebec. And those were, again, I did almost nothing, right? I just took the information they gave me and slapped it out on the webpage. And so I'll say it's growing slowly, right? Interestingly enough, the most popular state we have is New Hampshire. We've had about 70 people have fulfilled the requirements for New Hampshire.
Wow.
And, you know, I didn't launch it there. I don't live there. But again, the wildfire has spread there somehow. And it, most of the people, I've never heard of them before, you know. At first, it was people that I knew, you know, like friends on Facebook, right? Or mm-hmm. friends from the hiking world. But now, and don't get me wrong, this is great. You know, it's like people just pop up and say, oh, I finished New York recently. Oh, I finished Connecticut recently. And for $5, I'll send you a patch, right? And I've never raised my rates.
Wow. Impressive. I never knew that we were all over the place. I thought it might have been just Vermont, New Hampshire, and New York.
Like I said, New Hampshire, New York get the most traffic. And there's, I have a list of finishers for every state. And I don't know, Maine probably only has a handful, you know, New Jersey, Connecticut. Some states, it's just Laurie and I.
Nice.
we ended up doing Nevada too.
Ooh.
We did that one ourselves. We didn't have a lot of help with that one, but it turns out that virtually all the brew pubs are either in Reno or Las Vegas. And we had occasion to visit both of those towns. So we were like, okay, let's figure out where all the brew pubs are. And they were all nearby, right? I think the farthest one was like a half an hour away. So even though Nevada is huge, it's mostly empty. It's mostly mountains and desert, actually.
Beautiful mountains and deserts.
You know, yes.
We learn a lot from doing this. You know, we research where's a good hikes, and we also rely on people to tell us what they think is a good hike. And I'll be glad to replace a hike if they say, oh, this one's better, you know, it has better views or whatever. Mm. And we've kind of become poster child for I Love New York.
Nice.
So we've been all over New York. We've been Long Island. We've been up in Plattsburgh. We've been on the Southern Tier. We've been out to Niagara Falls. And New York is just amazing. I kind of knew that, but the more we travel, the more it's like there's all these diverse places to go. Like there's this place, have you ever heard of, called Eternal Flame Falls?
Yep, that's up in the Finger Lakes, correct? Or west?
It's sort of there. It's sort of there. And it's about an hour east of Buffalo. So you could say it's in the Finger Lakes.
Yeah, it's near there.
So you get there and it's a waterfall, but if you listen carefully, you can hear a hissing sound, and it's natural gas hissing out of the rocks. So if you flick your bick, and hopefully you don't get too big an explosion, now you have this little flame behind the falls, right? And I don't know why they call it Eternal Flame, but it's not very big. It kind of looks, I guess it kind of looks like the Eternal Flame in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
Honors the those who died in the war. But when we arrived, it was already on fire, so it was no big explosion when we got there. But it is kind of cool. I mean, who knew, right?
Yeah.
Maybe you knew, but I never knew. And so sometimes our hikes, you know, if you go to New York City and there's a brew pub, well, where's the mountain, right? There is no mountain. So we had to get creative. So we said, okay, let's walk across the Brooklyn Bridge. And you can literally walk on top of the cars. The promenade is above the car traffic. And then you get on the other side, you get to Brooklyn, and it's actually called the Brooklyn Promenade. And you walk along, there's like million-dollar houses on one side. And then the other side is a spectacular view of the Manhattan skyline. So sometimes you don't gain a lot of elevation, and sometimes you do, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's always about going for a hike, somewhere, and sometimes it's on the beach, right? Sometimes it's a rail trail, and most of the time, of course, it's at least some kind of mountain. And then finding a place to have a cold one. And when I say brew pub, I mean a place that serves beer, but they also serve their own food too.
So, I'm hungry.
Yeah, we're hungry when we're done hiking, you know?
Yes.
So I've had a lot of people will send me like, oh, this brewery is awesome. And I'm like, it is awesome, but they all they have is a jar of pretzels. So, you know,
yeah,
that doesn't put the mustard, right? Yeah. Or it could be the other way around. I get people say, this is a great beer bar. And they have food, but I'm like, well, they don't brew their own beer, you know? So I try to be specific about what a brew pub is on our webpage, but I'm always getting people sending me things that are close, as well as things that qualify. Like right now, the big thing is food trucks. And I'm like, well, that's awful close, but the food truck could come tomorrow or it might not come tomorrow, mm-hmm. or they could have a falling out, right? I mean, if they own the food truck and it's a permanent food truck, that's fine. But otherwise, it's like, if it's two separate people with two separate businesses, then you just never know, right? I had a problem in New York City where there was a brew pub. Well, there was a bar, I guess you'd have to call it, that shared a building with a brewery. And I thought, well, they serve beer in the same building that they brew it, right? And they have food. So is that a brew pub? And I convinced myself that it was. Well, it turned out someone went there and came back and said, they don't serve their beer there anymore. They had a falling out. So even though they're in the same building, you can't buy their beer anymore at the bar. And so I guess they must have had a big argument with each other and said, you know,
yeah.
No pound sand, right?
Yeah, that was my question of what the difference between a brewer and a brew pub. So now I really like brew pubs because I'm not a big beer guy, but I am a big food guy after a hike. So.
Well, we don't, you know, you don't have to get drunk when you go. As a matter of fact, we encourage people to be responsible.
Of course.
Have a DD and whatever.
A lot of places actually brew their own sodas too.
Yeah, you can get root beers.
Ooh.
Yeah,
I don't want to say a lot, but I actually have a challenge out there that no one has completed yet. Is to, you know, visit five for minors, right? To visit five places that brew their own non-alcoholic beverage.
Wicked. Get Luna on that.
Yeah.
So, like I said, you know, pretzels are fine, but we're hungry and we're thirsty. And
yeah,
all I ask is that you try a beer. And I'm not, you know, I don't go out on Views and Brews and say, oh, this was the best beer ever and this one sucks. I try to be agnostic, right? Mm-hmm. Because I might have a different taste than you do, right? Someone might like lagers and someone else might like IPAs or porters or stouts or whatever. So as Views and Brews, I don't judge. But if you want to ask me privately, I'll be glad to tell you which beers suck and which don't.
Well, that's good. That's good to hear. Excellent.
But again, that's just my opinion.
Yeah, that's so cool. I didn't know all that information. I'm glad you told that. Let's hope people get on that wagon and do some Views and Brews. I've heard good things about it, though. So, excellent.
Well, we used to have a gathering, I called it, every year, but it got to the point where it was just like Laurie and me and one or two other people. So we don't really do that anymore. It's mostly a roll your own thing.
Mm.
We do have a Facebook page, and the webpage has all the information you need to get started. Sweet. And anybody can go out there and post and say, you know, I'm going to so-and-so next month or next week. Does anybody want to join me, kind of thing?
Sweet. Yeah. I will post those. I will put those in the show notes. Definitely. That is wicked. Excellent. I think that's all I have. Do you guys have anything to say?
No, I just want to thank you for what you do for promoting the Catskills and volunteerism and your participation in SAR and other such things as well. Thank you.
I appreciate it. You guys have influenced me. Once again, a lot of people. I call you guys legends, of course. You guys, everybody denies it, but you are legends to influence us to be better for the mountains. So thank you guys 100%.
Well, if that's the
our
case,
pleasure. Thank,
thank you. And I doubt if our legacy will live on very much past our death.
Oh, no, I do want a bridge named after me. Absolutely.
I'll get one of those bridges named after. I'll make my own rock bridge or something like
that. Okay, thank you.
Oh, you know, as a matter of fact, we talked about that flat spot on the way up Balsam Lake.
Mm-hmm.
The muddy spot. I do call that Tom's Pond, so maybe that'll stick.
Okay. I'll take a picture every time I go up there and I'll post it and be like Tom's Pond.
Okay.
Thanks. Excellent. Well, I'd like to thank everyone who has donated. Thank you very much. Before we leave, you guys really helped me influence me to keep going. Everyone who's listening, hopefully they take in all this volunteer information and they take it and then pass it on and take it to themselves and do it for themselves because it's a great time. Subscribe on any platform. Look me up on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I have a website as well. If you have the time, shoot me a review on Spotify or Apple Podcasts or whatever platform you use. I will be posting show notes about the FFLA, views and brews, whatever I can for volunteering. Laurie and Tom, thank you so much for joining me tonight. Sorry it took so long, but I am glad we got together. And I thank you for everything you have done in the Catskills and the Adirondacks and the Northeast.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, have a good night. And I will, are you guys going to be at the club dinner?
Actually, Tom will be, I will not. My granddaughter's graduation party is Saturday.
Excellent.
I'm going to be doing double duty. I'll go to both.
He's going to go for a little while, but I really can't duck out.
Okay, excellent. Well, I will see you at the club dinner, Tom, and I will see you later, Lori.
Okay, sounds good. Thanks so much.
All right, have a good night.
Bye.
Bye.